years I've been known by many names. Diablo Gato. Olé! The Furry Lover. Chupacabra. Frisky Two Times. The Ginger Hitman. Long before meeting the ogre Shrek, I, Puss and Boots, just named a hero for saving a woman from a charging bully, is run out of town on suspicion of bank robbery, even though the real villain is my friend, Humpty Alexander Dumpty. Though there is still animosity between the egg and I, we reunite to steal a goose that lays golden eggs. Joining us for the adventure of nine lifetimes is notorious and very sexy cat burglar, Kitty Softpaws. And I must say, cochino she is. The journey of our favorite ogre and his fellow fairy tale friends may have transpired, but there was one other character whose flair and flamboyant nature was irresistible from the moment he pounced on screen. Enter Puss in Boots. Hate me, troll me if you dare. The furious feline getting his own spinoff is simply an unsurprising pleasure, considering that Puss is the biggest highlight of Shrek 2. Of those Shrek. In fact, if Puss in Boots had not been introduced, we would have not only gotten this film, but we would have never experienced the uncharted corners of the Shrek lore. Sure, Shrek lore is basically folklore presented in a spoofy fashion, but when you are telling a Puss in Boots story, it has to be epic and adventurous. The only thing more epic and adventurous than watching Puss in Boots in action is the environment and the amigos he has the epic adventures with. When the movie begins, all that is known about Puss is that it takes place before the ogre story, and he is an outlaw and a fugitive who was running away. And he has a grudge towards the egghead Humpty Dumpty. The audience does not know or struggles to feel a different dimension from Puss in Boots until the backstory explaining his bad blood with the egghead and the ambitions that we both had planting the magic beans, which I must say, those magic beans. Precioso, very precious magic beans. And climbing up the beanstalk, it was very easy. All we did was speak to the pendejo plant. And it grew. And it grew. And it grew. At first, watching this backstory commence and the underlying betrayal of it all does not hit me on the head due to it being a flashback. The real-time events have more of an emotional weight, but not for the reason you expect. It is not emotionally resonant because of how satisfying the teamwork made the dream work for trying to acquire some Precioso golden eggs, but the land of giants, the golden eggs, and the golden goose are all sights to behold. Humpty is a character whose conflictions make him more than just the one-note nursery rhyme you all know from your childhood. You know the words. Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. That's all I remember. Forgive me if I cannot state the entire nursery rhyme. Just how Humpty and I are on the same page in the beginning is what makes this character compelling. But when I get ordained the boots, yes, the boots are the only thing that matter. Excuse me, hairball coming on. But the boots are the only thing that matter. If you take away the pendejo hat, if you take away the pendejo cape, you take away the pendejo belt, you take away the pendejo catnip, all I need are the boots. But that will be any other time. But we are here. I am presenting it to you. So, my spirit lies in keeping the peace and order in San Ricardo. But Humpty's spirit remains relentless in pursuit for fairy tale fortune above the clouds, even if that means being stubborn and compromising his brotherhood. It is more than just a simple betrayal out of desperation that makes Humpty exceptional. It is just how redeemable Humpty grows to be, over the course of the film. One of them for himself that is the result of something he did way back when the magic beans were believed to be a myth that turns out to be one of his egg-scapades. But that is the end of all of the egg puns. Moving on. The second moment of redemption is one that is genuine and heartbreaking, because I always knew there was a good egg inside. Not one that was prone to yolk, but one that was very golden on the inside. The relationship that I have with Miss Softpaws is not as compelling as my relationship with Humpty. Although Humpty still has his flaws, not claws. He's not a cat. But Miss Softpaws no longer had her claws. They tried to create this backstory for her where it gets overshadowed by the preoccupied partnership between Humpty and I. Basically, she was a former house cat whose keeper took away her claws, and now she cannot use her claws in battle, which is why she fully relies on her sword and her skill and her sexiness. But regardless, it is great to see that I, Puss, has a perfect lover. I know the person that owns this channel that has a lover like that. Rotten Tomatoes gives an 86% recommendation. From the spoofy stories of Shrek to the spectacle of Puss in Boots, DreamWorks becomes tonally conscious as they transition to the compelling story of the Spanish swashbuckling swagger, all while expanding the fairy tale world. For that, this legend that is Puss in Boots, this story of how a cat became a hero, of how a gato became the savior of San Ricardo, deserves an 8.7 SOS out of 10. As a matter of fact, if there are any amigos out, if there are any senors or senoras or senoritas you would like, any senoritas, feel free to join my amigo squad by clicking that red button, or basically leaving a cloud mark on that red button. If you do, I will trade one pendejo coin for one glass of leche, please. The leche will be on me, senor and senora and senorita. But with all of that being said, I will vamanos on way to the sunset, and I will see you pendejos later. I will see you pendejos in about my next side. I will see you pendejos when I have a ninth life left.